Hi, everyone. This is Catherine Spires. You are listening to Smart Mouth. If you signed up for the newsletter and you are not receiving it, please check your spam inbox. It probably is in there. But if it's not, please let me know. Said newsletter can be subscribed to at smartmouth.substack.com. There's a new one coming this week. Subscriptions are free right now, but if you do want to become part of the team making it happen by contributing financially, please do visit patreon.com/smartmouthpodcast. Let's begin the show.
I should tell you, I love food a lot. This
okay.
is true.
Okay.
But it will break me if I have to decide every day, what will I eat? How will I cook it? Blah, 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 blee, blue. I don't have time.
Well, do you enjoy going to restaurants then?
Yes.
To mix it up?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. But yeah, but not all the time. But yes, I do enjoy this very much.
Okay.
Yeah.
That all makes sense.
Yeah, sure. I like structure. I need it. Chaos is everywhere. So I need something that I can control with some sanity. So that's why.
That's very evolved of you to actually know that.
Oh, I'm limited. I have such limited energy. So I've learned if I try to spend it on deciding which sandwich to eat, then I'm tired 20 minutes sooner.
Oh.
In the day.
Okay. Flula, how do you pronounce your last name?
Borg. B-O-R-G. Borg. But no one says it. You can just say Flula is great.
Okay.
And you're Spears.
No, actually, I'm Spires.
Spires.
But the reason you think that is because that's how it's pronounced in Germany.
Exactly.
Which is weird because I'm more German than I am Scottish, but I have the Scottish pronunciation.
Ah, yeah. Yeah,
Scottish, so that's Spires.
Okay, got it. That's what you're right. That's why I thought Spears.
Are there a lot of Spears in Germany, do you
think?
No.
Not, I don't know them, but this could be regional.
Yeah. It could be.
Yeah.
Probably is.
Oh, so you're Scottish.
Yes.
Oh, nice.
You could tell by how I punched you when you walked in,
yes,
right?
Yes, thank you again.
Oh, yes. You're so welcome.
Yeah. I like a good solar plexus punch. It's
the traditional greeting.
Mm-hmm. You have to be ready for it. It can be fatal.
Yes, but that's part of the excitement.
Exactly.
And I find that in a city like Los Angeles, people enjoy cultural differences like that.
Oh, I love it. They love it, especially when violence is involved. So yeah,
keep thank it you spicy. Again.
Yeah. Keep it spicy, spicy.
I like that. That's good.
Yeah.
So I didn't know what kind of music person to call you.
Mm, same. Yeah.
Songwriter?
Who knows?
Okay.
Yeah.
You work with music. You work with acting, comedy.
Yeah. I make some beats. I like to write some music and then perform it and scream it. I like to make techno jams, some hip hop jams.
Uh-huh.
I just like to get on the stage and go crazy and see what happens. I will DJ my own music and sometimes just like strange early 90s hip hop times.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's all fun. Do you do like a club night or anything?
Yeah, I have not one in the future planned for your listeners, but in the past, yes.
Oh, okay.
I did enjoy to make some guilty pleasures.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I take issue with the concept of a guilty pleasure.
Tell me, please.
Well, I think that unless you're, you know, hurting somebody, it's just a pleasure. Murder, guilty pleasure.
Ah, yeah, got it. You are referring in terms of the law.
It's a very judicial view.
Or morals. Morals and okay, I can respect it. Yeah.
Yeah, but if it's just like a silly type of music you enjoy.
Well, I should tell you, I have no shame about this. I just say this so people understand what the music is.
Good.
But I don't care. I will listen to Right Said Fred every morning. Who cares?
Love it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I have no shames in the games. I wear fanny packs every day.
That's just convenient though, right?
Yes.
They are extremely convenient.
Oh,
and
yes.
If they hadn't been something that we saw like our grandmothers wearing, I think everyone would be wearing them.
Also, I don't care if your Oma wears it. I will still wear it. I hope more Omas. I want it to be less cool once more so that when I do it, it's a very clear choice that I am not cool and I would like everyone to know it.
I see. Okay. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense.
Yes.
I've seen you do stand up before.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
It was great.
I've attempted it. I don't understand comedy in any way. So it's fun to just see what happens when you're on a stage.
What do you mean by that? Like, you don't understand joke structure? Because you are, I've seen you be funny.
Ah,
so.
Okay, good. Thank you. I just have learned that if I just am doing things that I enjoy, then sometimes something good will happen about it. And it's all about a situation, you know. If I'm doing it in a crowd region, people will enjoy it. If I'm doing it in a library or like a convalescent home, maybe actually still funny, but...
Could be.
We don't know.
No.
Yes.
That's why you got to try everything.
That's correct. Yeah, correct. Exactly.
So speaking of context and or whatever, you just said something and then I forgot what it was.
Oh, okay. Me too. Yeah.
You've been to Berlin with Conan O'Brien.
That's correct.
Now, I think that when he travels and he does those segments, remote segments, I think they're very funny.
I agree with you, yes.
So here's a question that I have about it, though. In all of them, and including your trip to Berlin, you find locals who seem absolutely bewildered by everything that's going on around them. Is it hard to find people who are that bewildered by, like, cameras and funny, loud, tall guy and...
Ah. Oh, so, okay. So, sorry to ask about your question.
Go for it.
You're saying in other ones you have seen, the people that Conan interviews seem very confused.
Yes.
And, okay. I think many people are very... So, Conan is a very tall, unique person of appearance. And also, most people don't see him in a face way. So I think the second that they are with this person that is not a cartoon,
uh-huh.
It's like, oh, it's a real human Homo sapien.
I see.
And then I will tell you, this is now specific about Conan. He's so funny, it's confusing. Like, he's like funny when you watch it, but then when you are interacting with a real life, I think it's like if you see like a dolphin in the television, that's fun. But then if you go to a place and you're like touching a dolphin, it's very different. It's like, oh, wow, this is real. And this, what a weird texture. This is so interesting. So
wow.
Conan in person is like seeing a dolphin in person.
Okay.
It's amazing and fascinating.
I love that.
Also, he's very funny.
Yeah, he sure is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I've been listening to his podcast, but we don't need to talk about it because it's way more famous than mine. He doesn't need the publicity.
Great.
That's what I've decided.
Yeah, get out of here. Conan needs a friend.
So do Germans and Austrians consider themselves to have like a shared cultural heritage? Mm.
We don't think about it so actively, but we do, of course. But we do think we are different. We are feeling, I think, distinct about each other. I don't want to throw syllables into an Austrian's mouth, but yeah, I think we do feel a little different.
Okay, yeah, yeah. Are there specifics?
Austria, to me, and this is now just me being a label, maybe rudeness, and maybe we are offending everyone in Vienna right now.
Aren't they always offended?
Well, yeah, but so are we. So who cares? It's more of a mountain place. Like everything feels more mountain, like rural a little bit. Even like the mindset feels more like people of the country. Very educated still, but there is a different, it feels more like a village. And this may be just me being rude, but I don't think it's rude. I think they feel, how do you say it? Yeah, it feels just different, I guess. I wish I can tell you more clearly why, but I feel like when, this is why I think this. I used to go to Garmisch-Partenkirchen, which is a German city, it's a town, but we are very close to Austria. And then when we would cross, it felt like I was kind of in the country. So maybe this is my limited window of knowledge that we are hearing right now. I think I'm an idiot.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fair, though.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
The reason I asked is because one of the foods that you chose that we're going to talk about is Linsertorte.
Oh, Linsertorte.
Yeah.
So good. Yeah. Well, I will tell you, I only know it because of my family, who is not from Austria, but maybe they like walked there one time and found a recipe and then took a train home.
Yes. Could be.
Yeah. But yeah, I love Linsertorte. I still make it myself.
You make it yourself?
Yes.
That's very impressive.
I like it. Yeah.
Clearly.
It's not so difficult, actually, to make.
Oof, yeah. Says you.
Yeah, says me. Yeah.
Yeah. What part of Germany are you from?
I'm from Nuremberg. And then my mother's from Heidelberg. So it's a very... Heidelberg is, we are proud of, the oldest city, oldest university in Germany and perhaps Europe. And it's also very pretty. Mm. Nuremberg is Nuremberg. Yeah, it's just, yeah, the trials.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's all.
Yeah, and a Christmas market. We have other things no one will know. But but Linsertorte is really from my my family in Heidelberg that did introduce it to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
I see.
Yeah, yeah.
I have German citizenship.
What?
Yeah. I do.
How is this?
Because my grandpa was Jewish, and about 10 years ago, my sister found out that displaced persons and their descendants are allowed to get citizenship again.
Your grandfather was in Germany?
Yes.
Oh, this is dark. Wow.
And yeah. Then,
did he escape?
Yes, he was never in a camp.
Okay.
But they left on foot down to Spain, took a boat to Cuba, lived in Cuba for a year, came to California.
What year was this? When did he escape?
It was before 1940, but I always forget, 1937 to 1939.
Sorry for a potentially dumb question. Was it like, this is getting bad, we need to leave?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Oof, yeah. Man.
I know. And I have no sense of why they had that foresight. And it probably wasn't foresight. It's just a feeling at that point, right?
Yeah. And I think some, from what I understand, I wasn't alive then, but like, I think some people were just like, this will be fine. It won't get worse. Or, ah, it's just a phase. I think people didn't understand that this was terrible and getting worse and worse. Yeah.
Yeah. And I know a lot of people think it's way too dramatic to say this, but could be happening again in this country.
It's a crazy, the beginnings are not dissimilar when there is a denial of things and, oh, truth isn't, doesn't matter. Facts are not important. There's like, oh, well, those guys lie. We're just lying a little more. And then it becomes a slippery, slopey type of situation. Yeah, it's very weird. This is a strange time.
Yeah, it makes me very uncomfortable overall.
I agree.
I think everyone, maybe not some people, a lot of people are very uncomfortable overall right now.
Yes, I think it is a very strange time in America. I'm very confused about why this is happening. Yeah.
Do you ever wonder why you live here?
Well, I know why. For me, it is for professional reasons, it's a better decision for me to live here. So that's why I am here.
Do you think about going back, though, in the sense that you're like, "Whoa, this is...
Yeah,
place
but
than it was.
I will tell you, though, Germany also, we are not without problems. And to speak of, like, I think there is a, I mean, I don't know the tone of your podcast, but there's a far-right movement. Like, the things that were unspeakably terrible and not really not allowed in Germany are now becoming active. There's a very far-right party that has now received some representation in parliament and things like this.
I see.
And in East Germany, former East Germany is becoming very tricky in those ways. It's a scary time. I think it's like somehow things are okay now to talk about. And we're like, no, no, it's not okay. Racism is not okay.
Oh, my
just
goodness.
Not okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe just a weird time.
I'm very, yeah, let's hope so. Yeah. Yeah. Calories.
Yeah, now let's talk about dessert.
Yeah, yeah. Segway.
A totally non-smooth one, but that's okay.
Yeah.
So I know that it's pronounced torta, but I'm
torta,
never going to
say
that.
But American would say torte.
Yeah. Yeah,
yeah.
So it's named after, it's Linzer Tort, and it's named after a city, Linz.
Yeah.
But is it pronounced more like Linz?
So I would say Linzer Torte. So a Z is more Z, but a TZ is a T.
Okay.
But this is, I would also tell you in Germany, many dialects, and there are some Germans, this is not exaggerating, I cannot understand these Germans. So there's like, in North Deutschland, they speak Plattdeutsch. It's like your Cajun, where you're like, I don't understand any of this. So it's like
this. I did not know that. Yeah. I knew there were a lot of dialects. My sister speaks Swiss German, and she was telling me it's very different than German.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, I can understand it a little bit, but I could not speak it. It's like Dutch sounds like drunk German. So it's like this a little bit. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
So you make this, so I feel silly explaining what it is.
Oh, please.
So for the listeners.
Yeah.
It's got like a shortbread crust. It has some lemon flavoring and cinnamon flavoring in there. Do you do it that way?
I use no lemon. So I use cocoa and then, cloves. Cloves, very important.
Oh.
But cloves are very strong. So if you use just a little too much of the cloves, it's very strong in your face.
I see.
And then you can use ground hazelnuts. That's the traditional way. But in America, I found it's more difficult to find sometimes and easier to find almond powder or crushed almonds.
Right.
So I use this. And then I don't want to skip,
no,
but it's like Aachener Pflümli is like a Pflaumen, it's like a plum sauce or gelée or whatever you would put as your, like, oh God, I don't know how you say this, a topping or something.
Uh-huh, sure.
I use I like some tang in my smang or whatever. So like raspberry is what I like.
Now, this is funny because some bakers in Linz get really upset if you don't do it the very traditional way.
Oh, I would. They would hate me. Is what
right.
I want to say.
Yeah.
Yes.
Raspberry jam is like a very, and plum, both the ones you mentioned. Yeah. You see those in recipes constantly.
Yeah.
But in Linz, they're all about the red currant jam. Yeah.
Who cares? My argument, I would say, is it delicious? Do you enjoy it? Then make it. So
right.
This is my rule.
Yeah, and I don't think red currant has as strong a flavor as plums and raspberries myself. Mm-hmm. Although I did finally realize what Ribena is, the famous British drink Ribena.
What is this?
It's red currant juice.
Oh, I will tell you, I have decided years ago that I just will make my Linzer Torte as I like it. So mine is not the same as I think a true Linzner Bäcker or whoever is making this.
I mean, I love that. You're totally right. Make what you like.
Make it delicious
yes.
to you. Yeah, yeah.
And then do you do the top lattice crust?
I will. Yeah. So the latticing, I have. It's like you have to sometimes weave it. Mm-hmm. I have stopped weaving. Who cares? Guess what tastes the same? Not latticed Linzer Torte. It tastes the same. So I like to just make it kind of funky and X's, and sometimes they are thick or thin. There is like a scissor or a circle with like ridges on it that you can use as you are cutting your strips. So they...
Yes.
Do you know what...
I guess I don't know the term for it, but it is a pastry cutter.
Yeah.
With the... With the edges, yeah.
Yes. I don't use this. I just use a knife. Who cares?
Like, perfect.
I just want delicious calories in my mouth. And so they don't have to look...
Any
beautiful.
Certain way.
No.
Yeah, yeah. Do you do slivered almonds on top?
No. I do Puderzucker, powdered sugar I put on. And what's nice about this is you do it and then the jam will absorb the powdered sugar. So then only the lattice work has the powdered sugar on it.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Very nice.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, I can tell you've been doing it for a while. You've
yes.
really personalized it.
Oh, yes, 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 yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I couldn't, the latticing of it or the non-latticing of it, it kind of, for people who are trying to picture it, it kind of does look like an American pie because there's like, you can see the fruit underneath the dough.
Exactly. And for me, it's there's not fruit like a pie. It's just the...
Just the jam.
Yeah. And so it's not so thick and so if people don't know, they may know. It's not a filled pie.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that what a torte is?
I don't think that... There's a direct translation
no.
because we do say tart, but here's what I think about baking words. And this is, I bake a lot just for fun.
Oh, nice.
But I think a lot of times it's just made up. Like you'll see something called a pie and you'll think, but that looks more like a tart to me.
Okay.
And some pies look more like cakes. So I think it's kind of, I don't even know if it's regional or just the words that an individual chooses to use.
Yes, maybe that's, yeah, I am in that group for sure. Wait, does it derail if I ask what you bake?
You can derail all you want.
What do you bake? What do you enjoy to bake?
So traditionally cookies.
What kind?
I like, for instance, an oatmeal butterscotch. I'm kind of trying to not bake with chocolate.
Why?
Well, one, I don't love chocolate, you know, like ack chocolate. I don't have that so much. I don't need it. It obviously tastes good. But then also the more I learn about chocolate manufacturing, the more it seems sort of evil. So I'm kind of trying to avoid
Staying
it on that
away.
Level too.
Okay. Yeah.
So yeah, I'm getting more into like butterscotch flavors plus sweet and salty together.
Oh, very good.
Very good.
Yes.
And I just came across a recipe for butterscotch potato chip cookies.
Whoa, this is strange.
I want you to have an open heart about it, an open heart and open mind.
Strange, not, sorry, like in Germany we have 5 words for funny. This is not strange like Stranger Things. Just like exciting.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, an exciting kind of strange.
Yes, yes, I'm not afraid.
Love it.
What I'm saying.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm really good at making pies.
Oh, yeah.
With, for some reason, I'm good at crust.
This is a skill.
Yeah, but so is it a skill if you don't even know how or why you're good at it?
Well, this is just talent then.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah. That's talent.
I see.
Yeah, nice. That's a very good one. I don't know how to do this yet.
It's very labor intensive.
Okay.
And sometimes you're like, why? Why am I doing this? It's It's kind of like what you said earlier. Like you're putting so much work into a food that it's just going to go in your stomach.
Yeah. So it's then you have to be strategic with it. Like
yeah.
Make, yeah. So I feel like with calories, you should use them very wisely. If you're eating healthy, great. But if you're going to eat something that's not healthy, it must be delicious.
Yeah.
You don't throw something in there that's not, if it's not good and it is also not healthy, what is the purpose?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Pick one of those.
Do you like ice cream?
Yes.
Do you have a favorite ice cream brand?
Oh, no, but I like a lot of the Italian. So in Germany, we have a lot of Italian ice. And so I would love Stracciatella, which is like chocolate chip, I guess. So I don't think you would like it.
Well, I mean, it tastes good.
Okay. but I like as the mint chocolate cookie. As a child, I had some friends in the military, so they would bring me to the PX and we would buy Baskin Robbins. So I know Baskin Robbins. Yeah.
Do you like Jamocha almond fudge?
Ooh, no, I don't know this one. We did mint chocolate chip or chocolate chip, mint, whatever the order words
yeah,
is.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. For you growing up, was Linzertort like specifically a Christmas treat?
Only yes, because we would eat it at my aunt's house when we visited. And so I had two aunts that always did make it for me. And now I think it is more wintery. So it's like for the summer, you don't really, I would not say let's have 8 Linzertorts. Uh-huh. It's more like cheesecake or something like this.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think winter.
Okay. And then there's also like cookie versions of them. Like the little sandwich cookies.
I will tell you, I've seen some that are like mini pies that are like maybe 4, what would you say, inches and inches, like 4 inches like this. I think those are fake.
Okay.
But this, once more, I will tell you, this is just Flula, not necessarily like German man opinion.
Okay.
Yeah. And the cookie ones I've not had.
Okay.
That are like mini, like baby torts.
Well, they sort of look like, they're just like a round cookie,
mm-hmm.
and then you put the jam on top.
Oh, yeah.
And then you put another round cookie, but with a hole cut out in the middle so that you can still see the jam.
Oh, these. And those, what do they call, what have you seen this, the name for these?
Linzeraugen.
Linzeraugen. Linzer eyes.
Yeah.
Okay. I know, I didn't realize those are the name of these, but yes, I know of this kind of cookie. When I hate something, I'm usually just say, I'm out, you're out. Bye-bye. So I sound very sassy today, but I don't really eat those. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I have very specific with cookies, German cookies.
With the German cookies?
Yes.
Specifically?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's like 4 that I will bake myself.
Please name them.
Well, Marzipantaler would be the best one. So it is like, Marzipan is very, as I know, dividing here. It's like politics in America. it's just people love or hate Marzipan.
Yes.
Yeah. So people know what it is, I think. People should know. It's just crushed almonds and sugar done. That's
yeah.
it. It's not like a large, crazy ingredient. So if you like almonds and sugar, probably you will like marzipan. Anyway, it is like a piece of, imagine one half of a cookie, and then on top of it is another cookie, but it's not cookie, got you. It's marzipan.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's very decadent.
All right.
Yes.
I love marzipan.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think almond is one of my favorite dessert flavors.
It is delicious. I remember like amaretto tasted like almonds and I felt very cool about enjoying that. It tasted like marzipan. Oh, what was I going to tell you? Oh, everything in all, many of the Christmas cookies have hazelnuts. We are all about, I think it is just because in the olden days we had many hazelnuts. So let's right. make cookies.
Well, that's the same reason I think that Linzertort is traditionally made with red currant jam because they're native to the area.
Yeah. This makes sense.
They grow like weeds because I think that they are.
Ouch. Shots fired.
Oof. It's a very old recipe. It goes back to the 1600s.
I believe this.
Yeah.
Not that you thought I would not believe this. Yeah.
But I'm glad to hear it out loud.
Yeah.
No one knows who wrote it down first. That's one thing. It can't be traced back to one particular person, which is common with these old things. There was the one book that we know it comes from, 350 years old. It's called Book of All Kinds of Homemade Things, such as sweet dishes, spices, cakes, and also every kind of fruit and other good and useful things, etc.
Wait, what was the first? Book of All Kinds of what?
A Book of All Kinds of Homemade Things.
That is a wonderful title.
Tilda likes it too.
Yeah. Oh, loves it. She, yes. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So in this book, this very long titled book, it actually had four different types of Linzertort.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Basically, the differences were in the dough. You could make a slightly different dough for it. Yeah. I suppose not everyone likes the shortbready type of dough that it is now.
So I don't really I would say mine is less with shortbread and more with like cocoa. Like cacao is in mine, which maybe there is chocolate shortbread, chocolatey shortbread.
I think as soon as you add cocoa to something, yeah.
Okay.
I think that makes it that.
Oh.
I think it's that simple.
Okay. I don't know.
Yeah. Some people, I kept reading people saying that this was the first cake recipe ever recorded. That's not true.
What was the first one?
Who knows?
Who knows?
But people have been writing down, here's a flour-based sweet thing that you can make since forever.
For all kinds. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know why in food history, I suppose in probably all the kinds of history, people get really excited about saying like this was the first.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Who knows? I mean, Germans love writing things down, and we are old compared to America. Yes. But I am assuming the Mesopotamians also had a cake.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
probably.
It's probably mostly made with honey and millet or something. Probably tasted disgusting, but it was a cake.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah.
But if it had honey in it, I would eat it.
You like honey?
I mean, it's sugar.
Yeah, that's true.
My brain would just do it. Yeah.
You know, we were just talking about people loving to be first, and it reminded me of internet culture of the early 2000s.
YouTube comments.
Yeah, first.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a thing.
Yeah. Did you get a lot of that?
Yeah, but everyone did. If you upload anything, someone will say first.
Does it like make you want to punch a wall, or are you just like...
The first thing?
Yeah, when people write first.
Oh, no, because that's fine. The ones I don't like it when people are rude and then for no... I'm like, why are you rude? This makes no sense.
Yes.
You shouldn't be... Don't be rude. Be constructive with your feedback, as Concord said once in a song.
Did they really?
Yeah, hippopotamus versus rhinoceros.
Uh-huh.
Be more constructive with your feedback, please.
I remember that.
Yeah, yeah.
They're so good.
Very good.
I love them.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes when people say mean things to me on the internet, it really hurts my feelings because I actually am very sensitive.
Yeah.
But there is a part of me that's like, hey, you think you're being a cool guy right now by putting me in my place, but actually you're the one sitting there making time out of your day to be mean to strangers.
It's weird.
That's not cool.
Yeah, it's very strange. I usually will just delete it.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I will delete, or if someone is always rude, I will just block it. I have no... My energy levels are limited, as we've discussed.
Yeah.
I can't spend it on this. It's too much. Because it can short-circuit you very easily as a human person with feelings.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
I got to get more into blocking people, I think.
Oh, just block. Why engage?
Yeah.
If they've made this decision for some reason, cool. But my decision is I don't have to listen to you.
Yeah. It's weird. It's kind of a different thing because in real life, if someone is continually rude to you, you'll say, oh, I don't want to hang out with this person anymore. But online, people can be mean to you a bunch and you think, well, maybe I shouldn't block them because X, Y, Z.
But in real life, they are hanging out with you. There is a physical, oh, we are here together. We are spending time together. So... In the internet, that's not how it works. This person can be any place. We're not hanging out together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so true.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hmm. Do you think you've gotten less sensitive over time to this? Like, did it used to rile you up more?
I don't read things as much. And I think once... I think I realized if I don't engage, it's good. Or if I just assume it's fun and have fun with these people and realize there's really nothing they can say that can affect me. I will play either of those games.
Okay. Yeah, like depending on your mood.
Yeah. And I don't think it has changed for me as much. I used to be very like, let's interact. I would do a live show. Before Twitch existed, something was called Stickcam, which was a live streaming video platform.
Okay.
And sorry, I just stifled a burp. Is that acceptable?
Yes.
Okay. And people would be very rude, but I would try to take the rudeness and make something fun out of this. But I don't have time for this all the time. Why?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not they shouldn't have to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like, yeah, you're totally right. You're totally right.
Who knows? I'm just trying to survive. Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
Now, some context for Linsertort is that Austrian desserts, or I should say sweets, because you can eat them for breakfast too.
Oh, yes, you can. Oh, yes.
They're really some of the most famous in the world.
Is this true?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes. Okay. Now, here's the thing. You think French pastry,
yeah,
right?
Oh, yeah. People know this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So the best part, well, this is, I suppose, my opinion. The best of the French pastries, they all fall under a category called viennoiserie.
Okay.
Which means, you know, Vienna stuff.
Vienna stuff. Ah, okay. This is interesting.
Yeah, so a lot of the pastries that we think of as French are really actually Austrian.
Hmm.
And the fact that the French will even admit via their name of it that it came from somewhere else.
Yes.
I think that speaks to how good they are.
This has two things in my brain that has... So number one, when you ask me about the differences, Austria has many things, of course. They like Mozart. Like this is a huge high culture thing that is very present there. So, of course, this makes sense that they would also have very nice, high-culture, tasty bakeries.
Yes.
And I will say, in Germany, we have very good bakeries. And I think Austria as well. But they are. Our breads and things like this are so delicious. I don't think we have a reputation for this, like France is having.
Huh. I don't know.
I don't as well. But when I think of like, oh, pastries and nice bakery, I immediately I'm thinking France.
Right.
But it's Germany, man.
Yeah.
Super tasty stuff.
It really is.
Yeah.
I've only been once.
Where did you go?
Just Berlin.
Okay.
I'm lying. I've also been to Munich.
Okay. Okay.
But only day trips to Munich.
From Berlin?
No, from Innsbruck.
Ah, yeah.
Yes.
Nice. Innsbruck. Nice.
Yeah. Cute little town.
Yeah.
Munich seems very tourist oriented.
Yes.
Still doing all the Oktoberfest stuff, yes, and all that.
Oh, yes.
Berlin was one of the most international-seeming cities I've ever been to.
Yes. It's huge and has many, very many things going on.
Yeah.
It's a cool city. I mean, I think now still it's cool, but for a while it was like, oh, the coolest city in Europe. Yeah, I don't know about now.
Definitely feels like it's a more chilled out sort of cool.
Yes.
Like, not 20-something cool, 30-something cool.
It's matured.
Yes.
Yeah.
It felt that way.
Okay, yeah. I will tell you, I don't know Berlin so well. I know I went with Conan, but I was not an expert.
Right.
For sure.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's nice, too, because you can discover new things for yourself as
It was
well.
Exciting, yes. I saw some new things.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's good.
Thanks.
So apparently the tradition of Austrian pastries in Paris, it started in Paris.
Yeah.
It can be traced to one person, Austrian guy named August Zang, or
okay,
however it would be pronounced.
It's a E-N-G?
A-N-G.
Zang. Okay. Z-A-N-G.
Yeah.
Okay. August Zang did it. Okay.
Yeah. It was all him.
Hey.
He moved to Paris and he opened a bakery called the Boulangerie Viennoise.
Man, Herr Zang bringing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And when he moved back to Vienna, he started a newspaper and that became the thing he was most famous for. Even more than, I mean, most famous by name.
Yeah.
I think the pastries probably had a greater worldwide effect than the newspaper.
Okay.
And I'm a journalist and I still feel that way.
Okay.
So.
This is fair.
Yeah.
What is this? What year? Like 18 some?
Yes, it was in the mid 1800s. I know, okay, it was before 1877.
Ah, yeah. Got it. Perfect. Yeah. Just curious.
Somewhere. Yeah. 1850 to 1877. Somewhere in there. So viennoiserie are, generally speaking, made with white flour and they're yeasted. Mm. So they will rise. The French edition was to start using more puff pastry. So we can't say that it's still entirely Austrian.
Right.
It moved. It changed a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
But among viennoiserie is brioche. That counts.
Oh.
Croissants.
Mmm, delicious.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's like the most French thing, but they're actually Austrian.
Oh. Croissant.
And everything in the croissant family, pain au chocolat, pain au raisin, raisin. I forget, chaussons en pomme, and actually Danishes too.
Danishes?
Yeah.
Okay.
Those all count.
I will take it. Well, I cannot, but yeah, my neighbor should take it.
That's a lot of world famous snacks.
That are not misattributed, but we didn't know.
Right. Yeah. And then the first time in 1877, there was a book written called Le Nabab. And it's the first time that Pâtisserie Viennoise shows up in print.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Yeah.
It sounds nice. So. Maybe it sounds better in French.
It does. Everything sounds better.
Kind of.
Yeah. German and Austrian is... The language is basically the same. We understand each other. It's not the prettiest. In the sounds. We have very many great poets and writers and all of this and composers, but...
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Our cultures can't be good at everything, right?
No. That's true.
So are you familiar with, the concept of coffee houses in Vienna and what a storied history they have?
A little bit, but please tell me more.
Well, the coffee house in Vienna is particular to that city known as the gathering point. It's kind of like the equivalent of the French salon. It's just not in people's private homes.
Yeah.
They're coffee shops, essentially.
Yes.
And you can, if you only order one cup of coffee, totally acceptable to hang out there all day. They have newspapers that you can read for free. You don't have to pay for them. I don't know if they're still hotbeds of intellectual activity or if that's just an idea that's left over from the 1600s.
Right. Well, this culture of having a Kaffeehaus where you go and we will often do Kaffee und Kuchen, coffee and cake and things like this. I think this is probably not so different from these coffee houses.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's like today's Nietzsche discussing, this. Mainly it feels like it's old people at exactly a specific time of day visiting and meeting with one another.
That's true.
Mostly. But it is very cool and I like it very much.
I mean, I did go to a cake shop at 4 p.m. on one of my days in Berlin and had an enormous slice of cake.
Wonderful.
It was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who wouldn't enjoy that?
No,
especially because, as you mentioned, cakes in Germany, it's serious business. They get really elaborate.
It's very good. It's not like House of Pies. No offense to House of Pies.
Yep. Just a totally different product.
It's a different thing. Yeah. It's not Cheesecake Factory. It's Yeah.
So I think to your point, it's always talked about as being in Vienna, but I have to assume that it's sort of like in the German-speaking world.
Yes, but I think you're right. It is more that country's history, or they are known for it, maybe more than other countries.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. So we were kind of talking about the cakes. They can be very complicated. They're often very complicated.
And
I decided that is why it's a tradition of going out to get these dessert items, because they're not the type of thing you can whip up.
Very cool point. There's something called a Schwarzwälder Kirschtorte, which is a Black Forest cherry torte. Which is very good, but also a normal person cannot make this in an easy way. You can do it, but it's many layers, and everything is happening. Who wants, you cannot really make, my mother is an excellent baker, but she would not make these insane things of intricacy.
You know,
it just makes no sense.
Right, you need a professional kitchen with so much space.
And why? Now this is the too much. Let's just go to the bakery and have a delicious one.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
See, your people are known for being pragmatic.
Well,
and this is part of it.
Okay. some of them.
Yeah. I never know if I'm German or Jewish.
Ah, okay.
Because I don't know how different in Germany in the 1920s and further back, if they were living two totally different cultures or not.
Exactly. Well, it's interesting, even something like Yiddish has a huge German over, I can understand Yiddish.
Right.
Much of it, because it's a lot of it. They're just German words in many cases. Yeah. No, I don't know. I wonder. I think the horrifying thing is that they were integrated. This is not a strange, two separate worlds that existed in the same country. I think that's probably why many people were confused. Why are we leaving? We're German. This is very stupid.
I think that's absolutely right, because there's some letters that I guess my great grandmother wrote where they, it's pretty clear that they see themselves as German first.
Yeah. As I become an age more old person, I start to listen more to history stuff and watch stuff. And I don't think we realize all of these things, how terrible they really, as a child, you can't fathom these things. As you become older, you start to understand the depth of these things.
Right.
It's just crazy.
Yeah.
It's insane.
I also had this thought, we're getting dark again.
Bring it.
But in American schools,
yeah,
the Holocaust is taught as this one singular, unique event. And I think that the problem with teaching it that way, instead of teaching that genocides happen constantly,
yeah,
is that we grow up thinking that was an outlier. That was the craziest of circumstances. So we don't think it'll happen again.
Yeah.
Because we're only taught about this one genocide.
Yeah.
But there's genocides going on all over the place all the time.
Well, it's a natural like Western world bias that I think we Europeans and Americans have. So like this happened in one of the cultures we are familiar with very well.
Yeah.
Whereas a lot of the other ones are happening in other parts of the world that we don't really know a lot about. We don't get a lot of African news.
Yes.
You know, the New York Times or whoever, Fox News, whoever doesn't cover what's happening in Nigeria.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's we just don't know.
So true.
Yeah.
So true.
Yeah. It's weird.
I guess we just have to overhaul the entire education system.
Yes. And mail everyone a Linzer Torte. Yes.
That would make everyone chill out.
Yes. Except those people with nut allergies. But yes.
Yes. True. But I think it's smart that you add chocolate to it because, you know, chocolate is actually supposed to be like a de-stressor.
Oh,
okay. You probably have to eat actually too much.
Too much chocolate. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I don't know if it's possible to eat enough chocolate to actually make a difference, but the placebo effect is totally real too.
I'm into it. Yes. Bring those placebos.
Yeah. They're
yes.
the best.
Yes.
In 2009... Linz was named that year's European Capital of Culture.
Okay, Linz, I see you.
Right?
Wow.
You got to figure the torta had a lot to do with that.
Yeah, 50%.
Yeah. At least.
Oh, yeah.
I have a question about some slang.
Bring it.
If someone says to you, Linzerschnitte.
Linzerschnitte.
Does that mean anything to you?
No, but you should let me say one more time, I'm an idiot. So it could mean something... I saw a book on your shelf that's interesting to me.
Which book?
The Momofuku.
Momofuku?
Mm-hmm. Well, Momo is a child book, like The Neverending Story. Do you know this?
Yeah.
The same guy, Michael Ende, wrote a book called Momo, which is it looks like a curse. So it's my idea is Momo and then, yeah.
So straightforwardly, yeah. Linzerschnitte means slice of Linzer...
That's
torta
right.
being assumed.
Yes.
Okay.
Schnitte. Yes.
Okay. Now, what about, and I really don't know how to pronounce this.
Okay.
Schöne Linzerin.
Is it written?
Yeah, I will show it to you.
Yeah.
This right here. Don't look at anything around it.
I won't. Schöne Linzerin.
Schöne Linzerin.
So SCH we make is like your SH. So schön. And then the umlauts make an O more extreme. So, eine schöne Linzerin would be, I guess, a pretty woman from Linz.
Is what this means.
I didn't read your
right.
Yeah.
So that's real.
That's eine schöne Linzerin. Yeah.
Okay. So I guess in Linz,
yeah.
if you say Linzerschnitte,
yeah.
that also means hot girl.
Oh.
So
okay.
A little slice of cake.
Oh, I like it.
Yeah,
it's
I do
naughty.
Too.
Yeah.
I did a Google image search. And you had to scroll down a little bit.
Yeah.
But first it was all pictures of desserts.
And then other desserts.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And they were all very statuesque.
Mm.
I think it's a certain type.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, okay. And it's not that they are, so just to clear for me, it's not, they must not be from Linz, but they have a specific look.
It seemed to be more like that. Like maybe that's a term that's only used in Linz, but it's about looking a certain way.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
Got it.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
That was a nice little note to end on.
Linzerschnitte. Eine schöne Linzerin. So you would say, if I say Linzerschnitte, people know. Like, oh, it's about ein schönes Linzer. Okay. Schnitt is plural. So it's a group of ladies?
Oh, gosh. I don't know.
Oh, guck mal die. Okay. Thank you for this knowledge.
Yeah. I guess be careful about how you
use
it.
Actually, you know what? Yeah, no. I will now. It's on my do not say list. Yeah. Perfect.
Or just check. Be like, how disgusting is this?
Yes, I'll confirm with Mama. Let's see what she says. Yeah.
So smart.
Yeah, yeah.
Always so smart.
Oh, yes.
Where can people find you on social media and whatnot?
Oh, just Google me, Flula, F-L-U-L-A, like you have a flu in Los Angeles. I'm on the things, the gram and the who cares.
Do you have anything coming up that you're trying to promote?
Oh, sure. I have an audiobook that's called Wanderlust USA. It's being brought out by HarperCollins, so it's very fun. Day Street Books. Yeah, yeah. And it's about me traveling through America and visiting different events. Try to understand them, but also to connect them to my childhood. Because I thought about a lot of American things in Germany. And so now I'm like going to figure them out and learn more about those things.
Oh, were you like a unofficial student of American pop culture growing up?
I think truly, not to be funny, every German was.
Oh, really?
Because we were so exposed to American music, called fashion, films, television, everything. We received all of the things that you guys did. And it's fascinating for us. Also, there is a very clear history between our countries and a huge, tens of thousands of Americans lived in Germany when I was a child. There were just hundreds of bases.
Right.
And so we were just fascinated, I think, by all of this.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
Anyway, yeah. So pre-order it if you want. Wanderlust USA. Who knows? Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Everyone subscribe, comment, and rate this wonderful podcast.
Thank you for doing that for me.
Yeah, of course.
That Catherine is so Spies, thoughtful.
Let's do this. No more timing. Each tear that falls from my eyes. I'm not hiding the remedy to cure this old heart of mine. I can dream about you if I can't hold it tonight.
The citations are pretty simple this week. I referenced articles in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and Smithsonian Magazine. And Lince's travel bureau's website had information too, good information. This is all in the show notes and on smartmouthpodcast.com. You can join us on Instagram at smartmouthpodcast, on Facebook in the private SmartMouth group, and on Twitter at smartmouthpod. The Patreon is patreon.com/smartmouthpodcast. Smart Mouth is a production of Table Cakes, a woman-owned Los Angeles-based podcast company. Smart Mouth is hosted and produced by me, Catherine Spires, and engineered by Mika Grimm. Check out all of our shows at tablecakes.com. A Table Cakes production.